Hello everyone, welcome back to this series called Finance Current Affairs, where we pick up some important financial topics and we try and discuss them with the help of different questions. So before moving on to the first question, if you have not yet subscribed to our channel, please do subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you can be notified about all our upcoming videos. You can also join our Telegram group, the link is in the description below. Free PDFs of these sessions will be provided to you through this very group only. So let's move on to the first question then, which says, which of the following correctly states the position 5 years after demonetization in India? So recently we completed 5 years since demonetization. When demonetization happened 5 years back, then the rupee 500 and rupee 1000 notes were banned. Okay, so the basic objective behind demonetization was to take away the problem of black money which is there in India and give a big boost to the digital payments in India. So recently, when we completed 5 years, there were some important facts which came out in news about the cash in circulation, about the status of the digital transactions. So let's discuss that first and then we'll come back to the question. All right. So let's first see what was the position 5 years earlier. Recently, it was in news that the cash with public has risen to all-time high. Okay, so what was the position 5 years before and what is the position now that we are going to discuss today? So there are two things which you need to understand. First, currency in circulation, and second is the currency with the public. So RBI print has the power to print the notes. Okay, now whatever notes are printed, some of them are released in the economy. So the money which is released in the economy, the physical money which is there, which people can use for their economic transactions, business transactions, that is known as the currency in circulation. Kitna paisa RBI ne print karke market mein laya hai jo log economic transactions ke liye use kar rahe hai. And currency with public is currency in circulation minus the money which is there with the banks. So how much money is there with the public physically is the currency in public. Okay, so currency in public, currency in circulation, both have been rising and have reached the all-time high levels. So what was the scenario 5 years earlier? On 8th of November in 2016, Prime Minister announced the demonetization, which was done to weed out the black money from the economy. So black money ki problem aa rahi thi, toh ye jo high denomination ke notes the, inko ban kar diya gaya aur kaha gaya ki baad mein phir naye notes aayenge, jisse ki demonetization karne se black money ki problem se deal kiya ja sake. So what was done at that point in time? 500,000 denomination notes were banned. So when these notes were banned, people started depositing this money with the banks, and these notes reached back to RBI. So ultimately, the money which was circulated went back to the central bank. So with this step, 86% of the India's currency was wiped out overnight. Okay, so ye decision ki wajah se 86% of currency jo printed thi aur market mein thi wo wapas RBI ke paas aa gayi. Currency in circulation kam ho gayi. The currency with public, which stood at 17.97 trillion at the time, declined to 7.8 trillion in Jan 2017 after demonetization. So jitni currency thi logo ke paas with public, that declined to a major level. A few months later, more than 99% of the demonetized currency notes were returned back to the banking system. So after these notes were banned, the new 2000 rupees notes, new 500 rupee notes and other notes were also printed and they went back to the economy. So the currency in circulation again began to rise. The cash which was taken away from the economy returned back to the economy. So 99% notes to wapas de diye gaye the, wo dusre form mein wapas hi market mein aa gaye. Now, what's the scenario after 5 years? What has changed after 5 years? Let's discuss that. After 5 years, the cash in circulation is still high and it has reached the all-time high levels. So, cash which was taken away was later on released back into the economy. And if we talk about the scenario now, the currency in circulation is at the record high levels. 5 years after demonetization, currency notes in circulation have continued to rise, although at a slower pace, because we also have digital payments surge. So digital payments ka bhi usage badh raha hai. Okay, iske saath saath cash in circulation bhi badh raha hai. Although cash kam pace pe badh raha hai, lekin phir bhi wo record high levels pe pahunch chuka hai. According to the latest data by RBI, the notes in circulation have soared from 17.74 lakh crores in November 2016 to 29.3 lakh crores in October 2021. So, jo currency thi circulation mein, jo 16-17 lakh crore ke aas paas thi 2016 se 17 ke beech, wo badh ke 29.3 to 29.4 lakh crores ho chuki hai is saal ke October तक के टाइम पीरियड में. ओके, सो वी कैन सी दैट आफ्टर डीमोनेटाइजेशन देयर वाज अ डिक्लाइन, बट देन द थिंग्स बिगन टू राइज एंड इट द कैश इन सर्कुलेशन इज एट अ रिकॉर्ड हाई लेवल. देन इफ वी कंपेयर दिस विद द जीडीपी, ओके, हाउ मच इज द करेंसी इन सर्कुलेशन एज अ प्रोपोर्शन टू द जीडीपी, दैट हैज ऑल्सो रीच्ड अ ऑल टाइम हाई ऑफ 14.5%. सो यू कैन सी हाउ इट हैज रिजन, okay, to record high levels. So why have we seen this rise? Because during the pandemic, GDP shrunk, but currency in circulation increased. So overall, this ratio has increased. People started hoarding a lot of cash. They started keeping more cash as a precautionary move because there were lockdowns imposed and people thought that we would need cash for buying the grocery or other items. ओके, सो प्रिकॉशनरी मेजर की वजह से लॉकडाउन के टाइम, पैंडेमिक के टाइम पे लोगों ने ज़्यादा कैश रखा, जिस वजह से ये रेशियो और बढ़ा है. नाउ मूविंग अहेड, प्राइमरली बैंक नोट्स इन सर्कुलेशन वेंट अप लास्ट फाइनेंशियल ईयर ड्यू टू द प्रिकॉशनरी होल्डिंग ऑफ कैश. सो मेजर रीजन लास्ट ईयर कैश इन सर्कुलेशन बढ़ने का पैंडेमिक है, जिस वजह से लोगों ने प्रिकॉशनरी होल्डिंग की है कैश की. मूविंग अहेड नाउ to the share of high denomination notes. So if I talk about the high denomination notes, before we can see that 500 rupee notes and 1000 rupee notes were there in circulation. So inka bahut major share tha overall currency in circulation mein. Then after 1000 rupee notes got banned, we came up with the 2000 rupee notes. So then the ratio of 2000 rupee notes increased. But soon it was realized that if we want to curb the problem of black money, then we need to reduce the circulation of high denomination notes, and so we can see the fall in the 2000 rupee notes. So zyada se zyada 2000 ke note honge to black money ke form mein rakhna easy ho jayega kyunki denomination notes ki zyada hai. ओके, सो लोग अगर सो 2000 के नोट्स बहुत ज़्यादा हो गए थे, जिस वजह से ब्लैक मनी की प्रॉब्लम जिसे कर्व करने के लिए डीमोनेटाइजेशन की गई थी वो फुलफिल नहीं हो पा रहा था. इसलिए ग्रेजुअली हमने देखा कि 2000 के नोट्स सर्कुलेशन में कम होना शुरू हो गए. ओके, सो मूविंग अहेड नाउ टू द डिजिटल ट्रांजैक्शंस, ऑल्दो वी हैव सीन अ राइज इन द कैश लेवल्स, but the digital transactions have also seen a major rise. It has also reached the all-time high levels. Okay, so the basic objective behind monetization was not only to take away the black money issue, but to also give a boost to the digital transactions. And we have seen that boost coming up. Especially during the pandemic, the digital transactions reached the record high levels. So number of UPI transactions, which was just 0.29 million in 2016, went to 4.2 billion during the recent time period. The value of UPI transactions also was at a record high levels. But then why do we still see cash in circulation rising? Because still people use a lot of cash for various activities, for all their regular expenses, for buying their property, for buying the groceries, eating out, food delivery, paying in cash for services like house help, home repairs, beauty, hair care, etc. सो प्रॉपर्टी खरीदने में एक कैश का बहुत यूज़ होता है, और दूसरा रेगुलर एक्सपेंसेस जो होते हैं उसमें लोग कैश का बहुत ज़्यादा यूज़ अभी भी करते हैं, जिस वजह से कैश इन सर्कुलेशन ओवर टाइम बढ़ रहा है. एंड पैंडेमिक की वजह से प्रिकॉशनरी होल्डिंग के चक्कर में ये और बढ़ा था. ऑलराइट, सो दिस इज द स्टेटस 5 years फ्रॉम डीमोनेटाइजेशन. द प्रॉब्लम ऑफ ब्लैक मनी हैज स्टिल नॉट बीन सॉल्व. ब्लैक मनी अभी भी है इकोनॉमी में. पीपल समहाउ वर एबल टू बाय द लाइफ सेविंग ड्रग्स ऑक्सीजन फॉर देयर डियर वंस एट अ रियली वेरी हाई कॉस्ट ओके ड्यूरिंग द पैंडमिक. Then there have been income tax raids in the recent months. So all this show that people are having black money, which somehow they are utilizing. Okay, there are fraudulent transactions happening. Unaccounted incomes are there from many businesses. So black money का जो ये issue है, ये अभी तक solve नहीं हो पाया है, despite of banning the high denomination notes or reducing their circulation. So coming back to the question now. We have to identify the correct statement. So first says 5 years after demonetization, currency notes in circulation continue to rise to nearly this much level. Yes. Ratio of currency in circulation as proportion to GDP touched new low of 14.5. No, new higher level of 14.5. So this is incorrect. Government's efforts to digitize economy have borne fruit, taking UPI transactions to record high levels. Yes. So first and third are correct. Answer is option C. Moving to the second question then, which says, which of the following are incorrectly related to the fresh set of norms issued by the Finance Ministry to guide state-owned banks for staff accountability? So recently, the Finance Ministry has released the guidelines to apply the new staff accountability rules for the state-owned banks. So let's see what are these new rules, then we'll come back to the question. Okay, now what happens is, see, banks give loans. There are lenders who are giving the loans. Okay, there are bankers who are approving the loans to the people. But what happens is, at times these loans become NPA. There can be different reasons for loans turning out to be NPAs. One is that to whom they have lent the money, that borrower, his business fails, he's not able to run his business properly, because of which he's unable to pay back the loan. But one more major reason for NPA is the lack of due diligence on part of the lenders. So ones who are approving the loans, they are not paying the attention while lending the loans, they are ignoring the necessary things, necessary facts and figures, and they are still lending the loans. So mistake on their part, some fraudulent action on their part is leading to a lot of loss to the overall system. वो लोग जो loan sanction करते हैं वो ध्यान नहीं देते, proper rules regulations follow नहीं करते, fraudulently गलत intentions के साथ loan approve कर देते हैं, जिस वजह से वो loans बाद में जाके NPAs turn हो जाते हैं. So in those cases, staff is held accountable. The people who are approving the loans, sanctioning the loans, they are held accountable and they are penalized for the same. Some amount is deducted from their remuneration, their retirement benefits are affected. So now Finance Ministry has come up with a new set of rules, because the earlier rules were leading to a lot of harassment of the employees who were into approving these loans. जिन employees की गलती नहीं भी होती थी, उनको भी punish किया जा रहा था. उनका भी हैरेसमेंट होता था, अननेसेसरी उन पे ड्यू चेक्स होते थे. बैंक्स अपने, अब हर बैंक अपनी अपनी एक पॉलिसी फॉलो करता था स्टाफ को अकाउंटेबल हेल्ड करने के लिए, और जिस वजह से उनका रिम्यूनरेशन, उनके रिटायरमेंट बेनिफिट सब अफेक्ट होते थे, और उनको हैरेस अलग से किया जाता था, उनको अलग से पेनलाइज किया जाता था. सो there was a major issue going on with the existing policy where each bank has its own norms on staff accountability of holding the people sanctioning the loans accountable, answerable, responsible for the loans turning into NPAs and thus penalizing them. So now Finance Ministry has said that new set of rules will be applicable on all state-owned banks, okay? And uniformly, same rules will be applicable to all the banks. Each bank cannot have its own policy now. So, Finance Ministry has issued a fresh norms to guide state-owned banks in adopting a uniform staff accountability framework for your NPAs up to 50 crore. 50 crore तक के जो loans NPAs turn हो रहे हैं, उनमें अब ये uniform उन banks के में ये uniform staff accountability framework applicable होगा. So Indian Banking Association is working on them, and these rules will later on be notified by RBI. This set of guidelines will be implemented from 1st April next year. Moving ahead now, what was the existing framework? So if I have to talk about the existing framework, what happened was, see, whenever loans turn bad, the banks conduct the staff accountability exercises to fix the accountability for wrongdoing or inaction. So staff accountability se check kiya jata tha ki kaun uske liye responsible hai us loan ke bad loan turn hone ke liye, who is responsible for the wrongdoing or for loan turning out to be an NPA. And currently different banks were having their own different procedures. Okay, so banks carry out such exercises with respect to all accounts that turn NPA, which made bankers reluctant about taking exposure in new projects. Now, when people who were sanctioning the loans, they are held responsible, they are penalized for the same, for the loans turning NPAs. So that's the major reason why they were reluctant to sanction various loans. Unko punishment milti thi agar loans jo hai wo bad loans ban jate hain, unke amount deduct hota tha, unko uske liye accountable rakh kiya jata tha, jis wajah se wo kai type ke projects ke liye loans sanction karne mein reluctant hote the. They were not willing to sanction loans. So credit growth was the issue. Easily credit available nahi ho pa raha tha logo ke liye, and this slow credit growth posed to be a problem during the pandemic when people starved for liquidity, funding was needed. So now new framework has been approved. So a loan can turn bad for various reasons. Okay, at times genuine business failure can lead to the same. At times lack of proper due diligence before sanctioning can also turn loan into an NPA. So in such cases, okay, where the people are genuine, they are genuinely approving the loans, there is no wrongdoing on their part, they should not be penalized for the same. So new staff accountability framework is proposed. Okay, so what this very framework suggests, it suggests that there will be a four-tier structure. So four categorizations will be there: loans up to 10 lakh, then between 10 lakh to 1 crore, then between 1 crore to 50 crore, and then beyond 50 crore. So for each of these tiers, the different set of rules and regulations will come up. Whenever those rules and regulations will be there covered in detail, I'll also cover the same. Okay, so for loans up to 10 lakh, staff accountability will not be examined. See, what happens is, if we talk about the small amount of loans up to 10 lakh, then even a slight change in circumstances, like a family crisis is there, or some shutdown is there, some kind of a health crisis is there in the family, then also those people are not able to repay the loans. They turn out to be an NPA. So if we start with the staff accountability rules in such low value accounts, then the overall cost will be lot of management will be needed. So small amount of loans have been kept out of this purview. Okay, so staff ko itna zyada responsible nahi held kiya jayega ye chote amount ke loans ke liye. Then for more high level loans, proper rules regulations will come up. The proposed framework will address the NPAs up to 50 crores. Okay, and the size, these thresholds can be revised based on the size of the banks, the business size of the banks. Two more things to be noted over here is that banks will have to complete staff accountability exercise within 6 months from account turning to be an NPA. So once the loan gets converted into an NPA, then within 6 months, the staff accountability should be exercised. Whosoever has to be held responsible, all those things will be completed within 6 months. Kiski responsibility rahi, kin ki wajah se wo loan aisa hua, unki remuneration deduct karni hai ki nahi, wo sab procedure 6 months mein complete ho jana chahiye. Past records of officials in appraisal or sanction monitoring will be given due weightage. Now, if you see, okay, this person is involved in sanctioning the loan and he had a malafide intention. So you will check the past record. Has he done similar things in past? If yes, then you will penalize them more. If not, then you can give them some relaxation. So entire record will be checked of that very employee. Moving ahead now, why this new framework has been proposed? Why we are introducing it? That's because of the existing framework, the employees were harassed. Okay, they were reluctant to sanction new loans because they feared that investigative agencies will come after them if the accounts turn out to be NPA. So CBI hai, Central Vigilance Commission hai, Comptroller and Auditor General hai, ye sab baad mein inspections karenge aur un employees ko problems hogi, to unke dar se wo loans sanction nahi karte the. So the step has been taken to protect the bankers and remove their fears of being investigated for bona fide decisions. सो जब वो सही तरीके से लोन सैंक्शन कर रहे हैं तब भी उनको पनिशमेंट ना बियर करनी पड़े, उनको प्रोटेक्ट किया जा सके, इसलिए ये न्यू रूल्स सजेस्ट किए गए हैं सो दैट पीपल विद करेक्ट इंटेंशंस आर नॉट पनिश्ड, ओके, दे आर डेल्ट विद कंपैशन एंड वंस हु हैव मैलिफाइड रॉन्ग इंटेंशंस दे शुड बी पनिश्ड. दैट्स व्हाई दिस न्यू फ्रेमवर्क हैज बीन सजेस्टेड. मूविंग अहेड नाउ, so this is the question. We have to identify the incorrectly related statements. So new norms have suggested a 2-tier structure, no, 4-tier structure. For loans up to 50 lakh, staff accountability will not be examined. No, it will be examined. For up to 10 lakh, it will not be examined. Then a uniform staff accountability framework for the NPAs up to 50 crores needs to be adopted. Yes, it would protect the bank staff taking bona fide business decisions from unnecessary harassment. Yes. So first two are incorrect. That's why answer is option B. Now moving on to the last question, which says, which of the following measures have been taken by RBI for better governance and supervision of banks? So RBI takes various steps to enhance the governance, to deal with the supervision of the banks. Okay, why I'm discussing this right now? Because recently in one of the speeches, the Deputy Governor, Mr. M.K. Jain, he discussed about some of the steps taken by RBI. So let's discuss some important parts of his speech and then we'll come back to this question. See, banks are a really very important part of our financial system. They are involved in financial intermediation, deposit mobilization, payment and settlement. So they act as the catalysts in the growth of the economy. If banks are into some kind of a problem, then entire system will suffer. That's because these banks, these NBFCs, they have a lot of interconnectedness. Any issue going on will have impacts on the overall financial system, hampering the stability. That's why there is a need to regulate them, to supervise them, to ensure their proper governance. So RBI takes various steps for the same. Let us discuss few of them which have been highlighted in this very speech. One is to enhance the governance. So what all RBI has done for that? It has mandated the listing of the private sector banks. It has come up with rules, regulations related to the composition of the board, composition of the committees, working of those committees. Then it has also provided the guidance on a fit and proper criteria for the remuneration of the people working in the bank, okay, the management, separating the role of the chairperson and the MD or CEO. These are few governance initiatives. So governance enhance करने के लिए RBI ने mandate किया है कि private sector banks को list होना होगा, उनको ये उनके board की composition ऐसी होनी चाहिए, ये committees बनानी है, इनके पास ये powers होंगी, इतने independent directors होने चाहिए, all those things have been specified. Criteria has been specified कि management में जो लोग work कर रहे हैं उनकी कितनी remuneration होगी, इससे ज़्यादा नहीं exceed करनी चाहिए. चेयरपर्सन और एम डी सेम पर्सन नहीं होना चाहिए, अलग अलग लोग अपॉइंट होने चाहिए. सो ऑल दीज स्टेप्स आर फॉर बेटर गवर्नेंस ऑफ द बैंक्स. मूविंग अहेड नाउ, आर बी आई हैज ऑल्सो कम अप विद द प्रोसीजर टू इंश्योर यूनिफिकेशन ऑफ सुपरवाइजरी अप्रोच. सी देर आर डिफरेंट सुपरवाइज्ड एंटिटीज, स्केड्यूल्ड कमर्शियल बैंक्स आर सुपरवाइज्ड, एन बी एफ सीज आर देयर, अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव बैंक्स आर देयर. सो आर बी आई came up with a unified and systemic approach where a unified department of supervision is created. So, एक particular department बनाया गया है जो इन सबको supervise करेगा. Why a single department, a unified department? In order to make sure that there is no supervisory arbitrage, there is no information asymmetry, and because there is interconnectedness between all these entities. इन सब entities के बीच interconnectedness है, एक दूसरे से कहीं ना कहीं किसी ना किसी तरीके से ये connected है. तो एक इंफॉर्मेशन सिमेट्री रहे, सुपरवाइजरी आर्बिट्राज ना हो, एक जगह अलग रूल्स रेगुलेशंस चल रहे हैं, दूसरी जगह अलग, ऐसे इश्यूज ना आए, इसलिए एक कॉमन डिपार्टमेंट बनाया गया जो इन सब एंटिटीज को सुपरवाइज करेगा. ओके, अ होलिस्टिक अप्रोच इज अडॉप्टेड टू डील विद द सिस्टमिक रिस्क्स ऑफ ऑल दीज एसोसिएटेड विद ऑल दीज एंटिटीज. सेकेंडली, आरबीआई हैज ऑल्सो टेकन स्टेप्स टू बिल्ड द कैपेसिटी एंड स्किल्स इन सुपरविजन. नाउ हूसोएवर इज सुपरवाइजिंग दीज एंटिटीज, they should have the necessary skills, the abilities. So a college of supervisors has been set who will provide the training programs for better supervision of these entities. Moving ahead now, some steps have been taken to strengthen the governance and ensure better internal controls. One is to strengthen the assurance function. So RBI has rules and regulations in place. It revises regulations related to both internal as well as the external audits to be conducted for the banks. Timely audits, inspections, related rules RBI lata rehta hai. Then is to ensure the compliance functions. There are various rules and regulations being implemented. Okay, basically these rules and regulations are provided by RBI, but they are of no use if their implementation is not there. If you are not complying with those rules, then those rules are of no use. So compliance is very important. RBI takes care of that. It requires the banks to have a board approved compliance policy, to appoint a chief compliance officer, specify their tenure and their authority. So rules, regulations comply with or are basically complied with. Iske liye bhi RBI ne guidance di hui hai. Moving ahead now, there are early warning signals and supervisory stress testing that are made important part for supervision. So stress testing or early warning systems, ye sab RBI ne introduce kare hue hai taki supervision improve ho sake. Then a web-based system is there, automated system, which will inspect, ensure the compliance and report the cyber security issues. So cyber threats se deal karne ke liye, cyber crimes se deal karne ke liye, web-based system bhi bana hai, model-based framework is also there, which will assess the cyber risks, advise on the necessary matters and provide the alert when any cyber threat is coming up. Okay, so cyber security ensure karne ke liye bhi measures liye hain RBI ne. Then digital payment security control guidelines were also issued by RBI to set up a robust governance structure. So these are just few of the steps taken. There are many more. The list is quite long about the various steps taken by RBI. This is what he talked about, Shri M.K. Jain talked about in this very speech. If you haven't heard this speech, then also you will be able to answer this question because it's a very basic question. Kya steps hain jo supervision aur governance ke liye RBI ne liye hain? RBI strengthening the assurance function by use of audits. Obviously, audit related RBI norms lata rehta hai. So we can say that one of the major steps taken by RBI for better governance and supervision. Early warning signals, supervisory stress testing, ये भी RBI conduct करता रहता है, stress testing, so ये सब कुछ supervision और better governance ensure करते हैं. Then is banning the banks from supporting cryptocurrencies. Although cryptocurrencies are not that reliable, they are posing problems for the system, but RBI has not yet banned the banks from supporting it. Okay, earlier it was that the banks have been intimated to not deal in these cryptocurrencies, but that's not the case. RBI clarified it through the notice as well. RBI ne clearly notice deke bata diya tha ki hum logon ne cryptocurrencies mein deal karne ke liye abhi tak banks ko kuch mana nahi kiya hai. Hamari taraf se koi ban nahi hai, although RBI is working on coming up with its own digital currency. So hal mein abhi tak agar hum baat kare to ye ban nahi hai. So this is not a step taken for supervision and better governance. Only first two have been taken. Answer is option B. This was all for today's session. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.